opportunities are indeed tremendous, and our next speaker is an absolute champion of those opportunities. Up next, we have His Excellency Mr. Sanjiv Kohli, the High Commissioner of India to New Zealand, to inaugurate the summit and to deliver the keynote address. Mr. Kohli has brought to the role and to the High Commission a very approachable, very unassuming leadership style, and I know that we've all benefited immensely from his warmth as well. He also brings with him a clear vision, a single-minded focus to implement that vision, and takes the Kiwi Indian community along with him on that journey. Mr. Kohli's style of leadership heralds a new era in the friendship between India and New Zealand. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me to welcome His Excellency Sri Sanjiv.
Well, thank you so much. I think the person who's written it has done an outstanding job. But I'm delighted to be here in this very distinguished gathering. And I thank INZBC, the board, the office bearers, the members, sponsors for this event, for giving me this opportunity. Let me also acknowledge the very gracious presence of Honorable Minister of Ethnic Communities, Honorable Parliamentary Undersecretary for Foreign Affairs, Disarmament, and Regional Economic Development, members of Parliament, our senior colleagues from Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Your presence here reaffirms the priority we both attach to this great relationship, a long-standing relationship, which has a very bright future ahead. But more so, I acknowledge the presence of the business leaders, the businessmen from India and New Zealand, because I think more than us, the public servants or the political leaders, the script of the future of this relationship is going to be written by you people. People who could work together to create wealth, to create jobs, build partnerships, and benefit the people and economy of both countries. I had an opportunity to meet the Indian delegation yesterday. It's a young delegation in terms of, you know, the companies that they represent. The focus is on diverse areas like agriculture, health, information communication technology, research. And I said, these are all companies which have come up, you know, as startups, companies that have been set up in the very recent past. These are companies which are eager to build partnerships. So I think that sets an excellent basis to have a long-term relationship. And more so because the focus of each one of them is on technology, something that New Zealand is world renowned for its creativity, for its innovation, for its skill development. So I'm very happy with the structure of the delegation, and I'm really sure that they would meet the counterparts and build relationships. I told them yesterday that make as many friends as they can. I mean, it's a two-day visit, and more often than not, these personal friendships translate into business successes. To them, my message is that it's a great country with great people. I said, you know, something common with us is, you know, like we try to find solutions, appropriate solutions for whatever problem we face. I mean, people here are probably better than us in finding the right kind of solutions, the right kind of technology. Some of the world-class technologies have taken birth, taken shape in New Zealand, and now are being tried on the global scale. The Indian delegation also represents the new spirit of entrepreneurship that's sweeping across India. You know, India has undergone a remarkable transformation in the last 10 or 15 years, and more so in the last 4 or 5 years. Honorable Minister of Commerce, whose message you just heard, mentioned to some of our accomplishments. As he said, the GDP has doubled in the last 10 years. We are a 2.5 trillion economy. The GDP per capita has increased by about 60% in the same period of time. And we are probably the largest recipient of foreign direct investment, and also the the fastest growing large economy in the world. And that's a position I think most experts believe that India is going to hold for a very, very long time. It will remain the fastest growing economy for years ahead, and also probably the main engine of global growth. So this is an economy, this is a market which offers you great hope, great opportunity, and you know, something which global investors or global companies probably need to seriously look at. Another remarkable thing about us is that, you know, all this has happened under our unique circumstances. We are a democracy, the world's largest, with unparalleled diversity, complexities, multiple challenges. We've never deviated from the path of democracy, and still, the last 10 years, we're growing at an average growth rate of between 7 to 8%. We've exceeded 8% sometimes. There's always this tendency to compare India's growth with some other countries. And the people who say that probably India could have done better, or there's an age-old debate of the economic cost of democracy. But I think as Indians, as people with very, very long and historic traditions of democracy, like people here, we are willing to pay any cost to preserve our democracy. I remember what Benjamin Franklin had said once. He said, people who are ready to give away part of their liberty for temporary gains in security — by security, he meant both economic security and physical security — deserve neither. So in a democracy, you know, there's always room for course correction, there's always room for introspection, and I think India stands at a very exciting phase of a very rapid takeoff. The recent IMF report said that the elephant has finally, you know, decided to move. As for our relationship, as I said, there are lots in common with both countries. We speak the same language. We don't need an interpreter to do business. We're both very proud democracies with great people-to-people links, sporting links. So this is really a partnership we all need to take care of, to nurture. And I think this is an opportunity for people from both sides, the businessmen from both sides, to jointly work together, jointly invest in this, you know, very promising and exciting time that lies ahead. And before I conclude, I was just, yesterday I was reading a report which spoke about Vodafone's subscriber base in India. You know, it's a British company, their home subscriber base is about 19 million, and the subscriber base in India is 250 million, which is, I think the subscriber base in India is much more than the total subscriber base in other countries taken together. So this is a market, this is an opportunity. Please have a serious look at it. The theme of this conference are very relevant. You know, aviation, tourism, these are areas of critical importance to each domestic economy in terms of the jobs they create, in terms of the wealth they produce, their contribution to the GDP, in terms of showcasing the country to the outside world. And especially between India and New Zealand, there's a lot of synergy in these sectors. You know, we're doing extremely well in tourism, we're doing extremely well in technology, aviation, yes, as I said before, I think it's time for a direct flight to happen. Both the governments have done their job, they've put in place an enabling framework for direct flights to start happening. We have some airlines being represented here. Please don't let them go unless they commit that they're going to have a direct airlines. We have the support of both the governments. So let's make it happen. Thank you so much.